So I've been digging into the research to find out what science says about the best ways to do warm compresses for dry eyes and meibomian gland dysfunction. And in this video, I'm going to share with you 5 tips that'll help you do your warm compresses more effectively so that you get better results with your dry eye treatment. Let's take a look. Hey, welcome back. This is Dr. Alan here from the Dr. Eye Health Show. And on this channel, we talk a lot about the eyes, helping people see their best, take care of the dry eyes, find better vision products so they're seeing their best. If that interests you, hit that subscribe button for us right now so that you don't miss our next featured videos. Now, doing a warm compress is probably one of the most recommended conservative first-line treatments as a dry eye home therapy. But to tell you the truth, when I was in school to become an eye doctor, whether you're an optometrist or going to school to be an ophthalmologist, they never really go into detail about how to do a warm compress. It's simply listed in your textbooks and in your notes from school and class that warm compresses can be used as a treatment for things like dry eyes, for meibomian gland dysfunction, blepharitis, chalazions, hordeolums, and different styes on the eyelids. But part of being a doctor and something that I value is constantly researching and learning so I can make better recommendations for my patients. So I was wondering, what does the research really say about warm compresses? What is the best way to do them? What's the best temperature? How long do you do it for? All of those things. And this is what I found. Tip number one is that if you are using the warm washcloth method for your warm compresses, where you take a washcloth, you hold it under hot water, and then you put that over your eyelids, it's probably the least effective way to do them. Studies have shown that because the water in those washcloths will evaporate, that ends up cooling your eyelids very quickly, and so you don't get that good long-lasting heat effect to the eyelids to melt the oils that are trapped inside the meibomian glands. There are a few different studies that compare different warm compress products that are on the market, trying to see which one's better. And if you stay tuned later on in this video, we'll go over kind of which ones to look for, including some of the ones that I personally use. Tip number two has to do with time and how long you're doing those warm compresses for. Studies show that warm compresses get the best results when done for at least 5 minutes, but even better after 15 minutes. This is based on one small study I found that showed that there was an 80% increase in tear film oil layers after doing a compress for 5 minutes. But they did show a full 100% increase after doing it for a full 15. And it just shows that people who have worse meibomian gland dysfunction and dry eyes usually have more rancid, thickened oils in their glands and will take not only more heat, but it'll take longer to fully get those glands to open up and release those oils. So in short, doing warm compresses for longer is better, and I personally try to go for at least 15 minutes myself. Tip number three is that doing warm compresses on a daily basis is better. One study found that after 12 weeks of consistent warm compressing, they noticed a decreased level of phospholipase on the tear film. Phospholipase is an enzyme that breaks up your tear film, destabilizes it, and increases its evaporation rate. So in short, being consistent and doing warm compresses every day should have a long-lasting improved effect over time. One extra pro tip I'll throw in here, something that I do to help remind me to keep doing my compresses, is that I actually leave my warm compresses in a box on the floor next to my bed, because then I'll kick it if I'm going to bed and I'll see that, oh yeah, I need to do my compress, it's right there. Of course, I imagine there's many other ways to try and remember and build a habit out of it. If you have any tips to share with other people in the community on ways to remember to do your warm compresses, drop those in the comment section below. Hopefully that'll help everyone out. Tip number four is about the temperature of your warm compress. Most studies now say that around 40 degrees Celsius, or about 104 degrees Fahrenheit, is the ideal temperature to be doing a warm compress to melt those thickened oils if you're doing it for that 15-minute time frame. But with caution not to go too hot, as 45 degrees Celsius or much higher puts a higher risk of burning the thin eyelid skin or causing heated temperature changes to the cornea of the eye, leading to corneal deformity. And I tried to find some studies showing some negative permanent consequences of doing warm compresses to the eye, and I couldn't find any, but there still remains this overall consensus that there is concern that adding too much heat and pressure to the eye could deform the cornea, leading to permanent vision changes. And that's why our tip number 5 is that if you are doing an eyelid massage after doing a warm compress, that you please do it very gently. Be very careful with the eyes. I think if your doctor recommends for you to do one of these eyelid massages, that you follow their proper instruction. If you want to know how I've always done it, I do have a video that goes over how I do it for warm compresses, styes, chalazions, and for Meibomian gland dysfunction. So I'll put a link to that in the video description, as well as in the YouTube card above. But again, it's a good idea not to push too hard on the eye, because pushing on the eyes could potentially increase the eye pressure as well as cause deformity to the corneal surface itself. One study even suggested that if eye doctors are recommending warm compresses, that their patients should come back periodically to have topography corneal scans just to monitor if there's any long-term consequences. But again, I could not find any studies at this time that showed that warm compresses resulted in some sort of negative problem to the eye. But I still think it's a good idea to be as safe as you can. Now again, there are many different ways to do a warm compress, and there's many different warm compress products and masks out on the market, and there are some studies that have compared the effectiveness of these different products, all the way from doing just the washcloth method to the microwavable kind of bead slash bean type masks, all the way to these LED infrared light therapies, even to electronic ones that you plug into your computer. And at least it is consistent that the warm washcloth method is probably the least effective, with compresses that hold more heat for longer usually end up with better results, with ultimately a warm compress that also provides moist heat as being superior versus compresses that have dry heat. Now, I personally use two different types of warm compresses, both of which I talked about in a previous video about my personal dry eye routine, what I do every day. And I first use what's called a Tear Restore in the morning, which is a dry heat warm compress, but it does have a convenience factor there where I get to keep my eyes open and I can stay productive in the busy mornings. But in the rest of the day, and especially in the evenings, I often use what's called a Tranquilize XL. There's also a Tranquilize Cloud and another one that's called Tranquilize Vibes. And I use all of these, and I think they're a bit superior, especially for someone who wants to do a warm compress with moist heat and providing more temperature for longer. Where studies with the Tranquilize do show that it holds that consistent temperature of 40 degrees Celsius for up to 15 to even 20 minutes. And I'm not being paid to say these things or anything like that. These really are just the two products that I use on a daily basis, and I find they work for me the most effective. In addition, for both of these products, even for the Tranquilize warm compress, which is more heavy duty, I don't feel like they push onto my eyes very much, so I don't really get that negative corneal deformity fluctuating vision experience. If you do want to learn more about these exact products or my personal dry eye routine, I'll put links to both of these products as well as that video in the description below so you can check that out. Hopefully you found this video educational and helpful. If so, smash that like button for me because it is going to help me out. Otherwise, I personally did get a lot out of just digging into the research so I can learn a little bit more and be a better doctor, all those cool things. Otherwise, again, thank you so much for watching. Keep an eye on it, and we'll talk to you soon.